Cantor Audio presents My Life with Piper, From Big House to Small Screen, by Larry Smith, narrated by Larry Smith. I was 29 years old and living the dream, or at least my version of it, when everything changed. I was in love with an amazing woman and had a rent-controlled sublet in New York City's West Village and a good job at a glossy magazine. By any estimation, as I now recall my life before it was tossed upside down, my girlfriend and I had no discernible problems. I was a senior editor at a magazine called POV, which is aimed at guys who wanted to make a ton of money and spend it trekking in Tibet. Tagline, work hard, play hard. 5 days a week, I walked 10 blocks to my job, hunkered down in my cubicle, shot the shit with the editorial crew, and settled into making life better for 20 and 30-something guys who already had it pretty good. And I had it pretty good, too. How hard can things be when your big goal for the day is to write an article for a grooming column on how to get the perfect shave? I was cruising along with my story, step 3, apply a pre-shave moisturizer to open up pores and loosen hairs, when Piper called to say 4 words no one ever wants to hear. We need to talk. For emphasis, she added, in person, right now. What had I done? Drunk dialed an old girlfriend? The 90s were hazy, but I did not recall that happening. Was her old boss luring her back to San Francisco to produce the follow-up to her smash infomercial for Sweet Simplicity, quote-unquote, the ultimate hair remover? I doubted it. The 20 minutes until Piper reached my office from our apartment were long, but I did what I always do, kept going. I have no memory of the first time I met Piper Kerman. I'm told it was the summer of 1989. I had a job as a counselor at a program called Exploration, or Explo. One part summer camp with all the usual stuff, softball, archery, and because it was on the rarefied campus of Wellesley College, windsurfing, and one part afternoon courses taught by college students such as myself. I taught one class in social psychology. I'm not exactly sure what we did for an hour a day for those 3 weeks, save for watching that scary video of the Stanley Milgram experiments, in which subjects administered what they thought were real shocks to their peers, and discussing the famous Zimbardo experiment that examines prison guard, prisoner role play. With much more gusto, I led a class called I Got My Tie-Dye at Macy's, the 60s meets the 80s. About a dozen precocious teens and I discussed freedom rides and civil rights, read Kerouac and Martin Luther King, and listened to a lot of Bob Dylan. It was there at Explo that I crushed hard on my first lesbian, Susan. I had no idea she was gay because I was a clueless 19-year-old and she appeared to be keen on another counselor named Leif, a short Nordic-looking guy who everyone fawned over because, well, he was an actor. A teenage mutant ninja turtle, to be precise, he played Donatello in the movie. Shortly after I realized Susan wasn't into guys, she decided she liked me and we hooked up. I had no idea then, for whatever reason, I would love a lot of lesbians in the next 2 decades, and they, oddly enough, would love me back. This and good hair are the gifts the universe has given me. Piper had been invited to speak to the students by my friend and fellow counselor, Kristen, as part of a Gay and Lesbian Awareness Day program. In 1989, teaching a bunch of 15-year-old summer campers that being gay was okay was pretty damn edgy. I have a vague memory of standing in the back of the cafeteria that had been set up as an auditorium while gays and lesbians talked about being gays and lesbians. But I don't remember Piper, who was one of the speakers that day. If I had met this Breck girl blonde then, I'm sure I would remember it. I was likely staring at Susan, who was certainly staring at Piper. I love Explo and was devastated when I wasn't invited back to work the next summer. Kristen, who'd been teaching there for a few years before me, wasn't invited back either. Her theory was that our joint screening of Spike Lee's She's Gotta Have It was our undoing. Apparently, some of the campers' parents got wind of it and complained about the sex and profanity, prudes. It was just as well. I was graduating college that spring into a job market in a deep recession, and I wanted to become a writer, so that summer was better spent learning how to wait tables. Little did I know that at a brewery in Northampton, Massachusetts, Piper Kerman would be doing the same thing. Piper and I arrived in San Francisco via very different routes, even though we were heading west for the same reasons, to reinvent ourselves. Going to college at the University of Pennsylvania, just 30 minutes from the South Jersey town where I grew up in a loving and occasionally smothering home, had me itchy to expand my worldview. Don, a friend since fourth grade, also had the notion to get out of Dodge after he graduated in 1991. The plan was this: take as long as our funds would hold out and see as much of the country as possible, with a vague idea that we'd end up in San Francisco. We camped in our blue L.L. Bean tent. We slept in our car and hotel parking lots and cleaned up in lobby bathrooms in the morning. In some cities, we called upon parents or friends from college, asking to crash in their guest rooms. We did it because we were 21 years old, had little self-consciousness and lots of entertainment value, and usually ended up being taken out to dinner. In St. Louis, we woke up to the smell of just-baked muffins my friend Allison's mom left us. On the kitchen table was a note that said, "Tom and I will be home at 6, and we're all going to go out for burgers. I've left you the house keys and a map to the city." We got high and went to the Arch. We looked for juke joints in the Mississippi Delta. The night we arrived in New Orleans, we checked into a youth hostel and then hit the town hard, and shortly thereafter were mugged at knife point. Briefly, but with enthusiasm, Don and I looked into renting an apartment in Kansas City and applying for jobs at the weekly newspaper there. We encountered a friendly anti-Semite in Texas and were gently propositioned by a threesome by a man who worked at the Carter Center in Atlanta. In Nashville, we snuck into Vanderbilt University's student cafeteria, crashed a frat party, threw up our dinner, and fell asleep on couches in a common area in a dorm. I remember, with absolute clarity, being curled up in the fetal position with a massive hangover the next morning and hearing the voice of what I assumed was an RA saying, "Does anyone know who these two guys are?" And someone replying, "I think they're Phil's friends." We were not. More than 2 months and a fun 13,000 miles later, Don and I arrived in San Francisco. I'd long before fallen for the city after a family trip out west and repeated viewings of Hitchcock's Vertigo, VHS. After discovering my mom's beat-up copy of Allen Ginsberg's Howl among her Mona Simpson and Toni Morrison novels, I started reading Kerouac and the Beats. My parents have always been a weird bundle of neuroses and contradictions. They never coddled me like Larry Bloom's parents in Orange is the New Black, but anyone who knows Carol and Lou Smith can see how they share the Blooms' overprotective instinct. My mother was the daughter of a family doctor who took pies as payment when his patients were cash poor. She worked as a high school teacher, then took time off to raise three kids, returning to school to get a master's degree in social work. My father was the son of a Russian immigrant, Morris Smith, whom everyone called Smitty. Smitty came to America at age 4 and lived the classic American dream, ultimately owning his own pharmacy in Maple Shade, New Jersey, a small suburb of Philadelphia. My dad is now in his early 70s and still practices law in a small firm he runs in South Jersey, in the same town where he and my mom were high school sweethearts. My two sisters and I grew up comfortably, about 15 minutes away from our parents' own hometown, and were raised in what was a conventional existence. Our town was small, leafy, Republican, and oddly, dry. But in ways that seem much weirder from my own newly acquired perspective as a parent, my folks were unconventional. They took my two sisters and me to see Saturday Night Fever in 1977 and covered my 7-year-old sister's eyes during the nude scenes. We were the youngest people at the Eddie Murphy concert. "You know the show contains very graphic language," said the usher. "Yes," said my dad. And for my 13th birthday, I took a dozen friends to see Pink Floyd, The Wall. We were never spoiled, but rather showered with love, with guilt, with expectation. No one was tiger-mommed in my family, but my sisters and I caught an intense work ethic by osmosis. It wasn't until I graduated from high school that I realized most middle-class dads back then didn't work 6 days a week. With the help of grandparents, who embraced every early bird special they ever met, I still have a soft spot for the Olive Garden, my parents put three children through college. Their terms and conditions: we were not allowed to apply to school on the West Coast. So perhaps it was both my destiny and suburban boy rebellion to head west as soon as I was on my own. In the early 90s, San Francisco was still years away from its first tech boom, and you could show up with little money and make your way. My 6-week search for a place to live ended when I wandered into a garage sale taking place inside a 3-bedroom apartment in the Lower Haight area. Everything in the apartment was for sale, and the occupants were determined to empty the contents as quickly as possible. A deal was soon brokered. For a grand, Don and I would be the proud owners of everything left over, not limited, but including a TV and VCR, one sunken ratty brown couch, two beds and a mattress in a room with a loft, one picnic table that doubled as the kitchen table, a large, working, smelly, fish-filled aquarium. No fewer than 60 wicker baskets of various shapes and sizes that all hung off thumbtacks on a large wall in the kitchen, and a cat named Woody. For $800 a month, it was all ours. I got an internship at SF Weekly, the city's alternative newspaper, and a series of jobs waiting tables at increasingly worse restaurants, culminating in Pizzeria Uno, where I served $9 lunch specials and drank after my shifts like only a 20-something with tip money.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.